Welcome to your own version of Bill Murray's Groundhog Day. It is, this is the fourth and the last in a series on friendship. And it's been good to be with you. Let me make a public service announcement and then we'll get into today's topic. Last week I opened a subject but probably didn't finish it very well. Let me give you an invitation to something. It's just campus-wide, whoever wants to, it's free, nobody's required, there's no grades, there's no paper, there's no reading, there's nothing. But, you'd cheer on anything for that, but I'm going to do a two-night seminar, the last Monday night in February, and then be the Tuesday night that starts of March. From the time you were in fifth grade, they started putting you in classes called the Facts of Life. And the facts of life have been shoved down your throat over and over and over again as far as the subject. We're going to kind of cross out the of life and go the facts of love. And so I'm going to do a two-night series. How do you stay in love with someone the rest of your life? How do you know who you ought to love? What's even falling in love mean? How do those couples that grow old together, how do they do that? And good people who want to love each other, but it doesn't work, why doesn't it? And so it's just open. Anybody on campus that wants it, we'll be in here about 2 hours on Monday night, the 29th, and then about an hour and a half or so on Tuesday night, March 1st. You are very welcome to come. If anybody wants to come, we'll probably do an RSVP for a drawing. For example, first place is, I don't know, coupons to Taco Bell. And so you could have that. Second place is coupons to Taco Bell, but you have to take Randy and Julie with you. Third place is coupons to Taco Bell, but you have to give them to Randy and Julie. So anyhow, that would be kind of how we would work that out. But there'll be more stuff on that coming. Conflict. We're going to talk about conflict this morning. Conflict is a part of life. It's as normal as breathing. Conflict is just part of what we do to be alive. You're going to have conflict with roommates. You're going to have conflict with friends. You're going to have conflict with very, very good friends. You're going to have conflict with those you date. You're going to have conflict with the one you marry. You're going to have conflict with your kids. You're going to have conflict on any church staff you're on. You're going to have conflict anywhere you work. It's a part of life. And conflict is not an ugly word. It can be made ugly, but in itself, it's not ugly. In itself, conflict basically means I just reorder the values different than you might, or I say things different than you might. Or conflict is I hurt your feelings when I didn't mean to, and or maybe I did mean to. And conflict is just a part of what it means. You have to be skilled at conflict. When there's skills in life you just have to have. When you were little, it was pretty important that you learned how to dress yourself. That's a life skill you're going to pretty well need well until you get old. I'm 3 years away, okay? You need to know how to pick up a knife and a fork and try to eat with some neatness. Some are still working on that skill. There are life skills you have to have, and one of them is conflict. If you're not good, if you're not skilled at conflict, you're not skilled at life, and you're behind the eight ball, and honestly, you're dangerous. Everybody has to be skilled at that. In general, this is too big a subject for one day, but in general, if we make a couple of caricatures, a couple of cartoonish kinds of things, most of us fail in one of these two areas, at least as a tendency. The one tendency you may be is that you fail because you're a turtle. And what that means is when conflict comes, you just pull in and you shut down and you get inside your own little private house. Maybe it's because that's how you get revenge. I will just shut you out. I'm done with you. I'm shutting up. I'm going to starve you to death, so to speak. And so you turtle up. Maybe because it's you're frightened. I don't know what to do with conflict. I'm afraid I'll make a mistake. I'm afraid I'll say something wrong. I'll make it worse. I don't know what to say. My brain freezes up. So you just go into a turtle. And that's not helpful. If that's what your tendency is, need to repent. Doesn't work well. The other caricature is, and by the way, Rick Warren is the one who uses this phrase. Maybe it's because you're a skunk. Man, you just spray everywhere in conflict. Man, I'm telling you what, you stink the whole place up. I got something to say, and you're going to hear it, and everybody's going to hear it. And so turtles and skunks sort of exist in life. And you probably have a tendency toward one or the other. Do not point to anybody in this room, please. Those are both pretty unhealthy when Christ called us to be peacemakers. Skunks don't do it well, and turtles don't do it well. Peacemakers. Maybe another way to say the same thing, and I'm just trying to get some summaries in before we get started. When we war in unhealthy ways, here's another way, I'm using another set of metaphors. When we war in unhealthy ways, tends to be three different ways that I would use this metaphor. One way that's unhealthy that we war is you're kind of like a Navy battleship. And some of you have this tendency, you grew up in this family, this is how you do it. You pull up next to the island you're ticked at, and you just start pulling every gun that there's imaginable. I mean, the cannons start going off, and the salvo goes, and you just bombard the island with everything you can think of. And you said everything you could think of, and you started to pull away from the island and found one more shell. Came back and went in and lobbed one more in. I need to tell you, this is what you need to hear. And so Navy salvo, but nobody likes that. You look at people that do Navy salvo, and we back up and go, wow, that's ugly. That's unsophisticated. So maybe you war a different way. Maybe you do a more classy way. You're the sniper. I say almost nothing, but zing, boom, one little shot, one shot. And so your way of dealing with it is not Navy salvo. That's unclassy. I just put the one little shot in. Maybe 3 weeks later, but I get my shot in. It may look more sophisticated, but it's just like the Navy salvo. There's still a dead body in the ditch. I just chose a different way. Or maybe the third way you do it. Maybe the third way you war that's very unhealthy is you simply say, I don't fire anything. You use more, think back medieval, castle. I just starve them out. I just put a siege around them. I shut down my emotions. I give one or two word answers to everything they say. I give them no emotional investment. I give them no emotional contact. I'm just going to starve them out. I'm going to just starve them until they are begging me to change and become, because they're wrong and they're going to confess. And so you starve people out. None of those are peacemakers. We have unhealthy ways. Julie's going to pick a couple of things she's going to talk about, and then I'm going to take us to a passage that literally is a passage that changed my life. And so what we're going to do this morning is try to deal with conflict.
I suppose the most important thing to do when you start dealing with conflict is to decide first who needs to be confronted. And surprisingly, it's not going to be the other person. The person that needs confronted first, it's you. It's me. And the reason being is because we all have this self playing deep inside of us, this internal struggle that is just constant, this self-absorption, this self-centeredness. I pulled into the drive today into Ozark, and I felt that come to the head just a little bit, because when I looked at the sign, it said Randy Gariss speaking. Didn't say Julie.
I might have had something to do with that. I don't know.
I'm kidding, but we just do struggle with it. And the reason we have conflict in the first place is because your wants have the audacity to come up and butt up against my wants. And when I want my things my way and you want things your way, it creates a situation where it can get very tense and very messy. If you hear anything from me, listen to this. Self is just like oil and water. When you come in the midst of an argument in a messy situation, self is always going to rise to the top, and it's going to cloud your perceptions. I'll see this me first mentality in you in those kinds of situations, but I'm going to struggle to see it in me. I'm just blinded. Why is that? Jeremiah 17:9 tells us. He says, in that scripture, the heart is deceitful above all things. Above all things. No, nothing lies like my heart does. What he's saying in that scripture is, I can't trust myself to tell me the truth about myself. I lie to me. I con myself. Maybe that's why it's called conflict. Because we con each other. I have a shocking ability to justify my every action, my behaviors, my words. Randy's up here, so I'll use him for an illustration because he's handy. You know, when we were first married, and this has just been the pattern for me and probably for him in our marriage. Anytime we came into an argument, from my side, I was the one that was right. He was the one that was wrong. And the sooner he would realize that, the better things would get. When I looked at those situations, I was the one that always took the high road. He took the low road. I was the one that was righteous. He was the stinker. I was the mature one. He was the immature. Just a quick illustration of this is when we were first married, I don't know why, but I needed to be a good housewife. I wanted things neat and organized. I'm still that way. I don't know where it came from. My mother would say I was never that way growing up, but boy, when I was married and I got my own household, I wanted things straightened up. Carla Scott's agreeing with me. She's the same way. And so some days I would be really working hard. It'd be a Saturday or whatever, and I am sweeping and I am doing laundry. And this guy, you know what he's doing? He's sitting in the recliner. And he's got the TV on and he's watching sports. And he'd try to make it look like he was doing something good because he had his Bible in front of him with notepaper. Like he was working on his sermon. But sometimes I watched from the corner
You're
of the room.
You're pretty well done now. It's time for you to move.
Sometimes I watched from the corner of the room, and his eyes were more focused on the TV than they were this sermon, this Bible. See, and there'd finally come this place where he would look up at me, and he'd say, are you upset with me? No. No. Because, see, I was rehearsing in my mind all that. Randy was a great debater, and I knew this was going to come to a head one of these days. And I was working in my mind all the things I was going to tell back to him. And what was happening is you can't solve a conflict with that kind of an attitude going on. It just won't happen. And I had distorted the truth. I'd forgotten about all the time that he'd been spending up at his uncle's, driving the tractor for 8, 10 hours, 12 hours at a time, all during the week. I'd forgotten the time he'd been spending in a church working. And I had just distorted the truth. So how do you do something with that? James 4 gives us a good understanding. He talks about the very thing that we're talking about here with this conflict. What causes the quarrels and fights among you? Don't they come from the evil desires at war within you? It's our ego, it's our pride that causes the conflict. He will even go so extreme as to say, you want what you don't have, so you scheme and you kill to get it. Good night, I've never gotten that crazy with my distortions or my lying to myself. And he would bring up murder, and I think he says it because never underestimate the destructiveness of ego. I was in at Dollar General the other day. I was picking out some Lay's potato chips and whatever else I needed, and as I had my head stuck down in the Lay's potato chips, on the other side of the whatever you call it, the aisle. That was hard. On the other side of the aisle, there's a there's a fight going on. And it's a woman and a man. I almost started crying. I have never heard such vulgarities used in a conflict. And I mean, he was beating her up. And she was coming right back in at him. But the pain in her voice was unbelievable. And I'm listening to this. You can't help but listen to it. And I finally went around the corner. And I was so surprised at what I saw. I don't know what I thought I was going to see, but I saw this handsome young couple that would have been quite educated, I'm sure. And there they are talking like that. And I said to him, I don't want to intrude, but do y'all need some help? And they just got these sheepish faces, and they said, no, we're fine. Thank you. And as I went around the corner, they were right back at it. I mean, it really does get serious here. As I went on down through James 4 this time, you know, I've always come to this place where it says, do you realize that friendship the world makes you an enemy of God? It sounded like he was changing the subject. No, he's not changing the subject. He's just saying that the world, this is how they live, with ego above everything and pride and self-centeredness. But here's the problem. You live like the world, you're going to pay the world. You're going to pay for it. And so what's the solution? He comes down further in James and he says this in verse 6. But God gives us even more grace to stand against such evil desires. As the scripture says, God opposes the proud but favors the humble. So humble yourselves before God. Resist the devil. He will flee from you. Come close to God, and God will come close to you. So before I can ever go and confront somebody else, God's got to confront me. He's got to take care of my ego. I've got to see myself as I really am and as I bow down before Him. And this Father who can see who I am, who can read my heart like a book, and has the ability to show me my own sin, then I can finally repent of me. That's what James is talking about. So when I finally come to a peace in myself, when I finally quiet this ego inside of me, then I can have peace with the one that I'm struggling with. There's another thing that you've got to learn to do is when we finally come face to face and we've gone through this being confronted by God, probably the very next thing we need to do is you got to learn to listen. James says, be quick to listen and slow to speak. We're given two ears and one mouth for a reason. You're supposed to listen twice as much. Ever been in a situation where you felt like you weren't being listened to? In our first ministry, there was a day I was about 9 months pregnant, and with our first baby, and I'm about 21 years old, I believe it was, 22. And this was our first full-time ministry. And our ministry had been going well, and we were growing, and unfortunately we were drawing. It was fortunate for us, but unfortunately for another small church, we had kind of what they thought stolen some of their people because our youth group was growing and they had nothing. And I understand the hurt in that situation. But I got a phone call one morning that said this: are you Mrs. Gariss? I said, yes. She said, I just want to tell you, it's an anonymous phone call, but I knew who it was. I just want to tell you that before you have that baby of yours, I'm going to make sure your husband is fired. Click. And I mean, I'm just a young kid, and I'm going, what is happening here? And I'm thinking, how nice it would have been if I could have just got in a word, if she'd have just listened to me, but she didn't. There was another situation in that ministry. It taught me a lot. And we loved that ministry, but I'll never forget when I came out of Bible study one day, I'd been teaching, and a woman comes to me, and she said, I thought you might want to know. You kind of offended so-and-so over here, and you might want to take care of that. I said, I offended her? How in the world could I have offended her? Well, why don't you just, maybe you'll want to find out. So I can't stand to have somebody upset with me, so I called her immediately. And this was her response. Well, that's not all you've done. I mean, this was a dear friend, I thought. So I grabbed Randy and I said, I think we better hightail it out to her house and let's go have a talk. And when we got in there, she had rehearsed a list of wrongs for so long that she could just fire them off. And it wasn't just me, he got in on it too.
Being married to you is dangerous.
And I was thinking, this was restored eventually, but it took a while because somebody's got to listen sometime. Two ways, people, we got to listen. First of all, you've got to give someone a chance to give their perceptions, their side. And you can do that. You can quiet your own self. And give them a chance to talk. If you've been confronted by God first, and then you can listen with this unbiased, unprejudiced way, and you can truly hear their heart. But there's another way you got to listen. Emotions speak louder than words. And glued on to every one of those sentences they're going to throw at you, there's going to be anger and frustration and hurt. We're both quoting Rick Warren, but Rick Warren has said many, many times, hurt people hurt people. And the times we have to pour into someone else is the times we don't necessarily want to do it because they're hurting back at us. And that's when the times are they need it the most. So be willing to be confronted by God before you go and do anything, and then learn how to listen correctly.
I don't care how wrong the other person is, and they may well be entirely in the wrong. Her first point is right. Even if they're entirely in the wrong, I've got a part of me that has to be worked over by God. There's a part of me that has self. So it's not even a question of, well, they're wrong and I'm right. The question is, okay, maybe they are, but has your own heart and soul been rid of its own selfishness? And the issue of listening is really, really hard. Everybody said when you were mad, you know, to count to 10 before you said anything, but nobody told you what to think about while you were counting to 10. So most of us are thinking what we're going to say. Somewhere in the middle, when I'm hurt and offended, I'm going to go, this is the place I've got to learn to listen. My ministry at College Heights was an extraordinary adventure. Treated better than I ever deserved. I got to spend a lifetime across town. But it started with the same kind of danger that every ministry does. There was an elder, strong personality elder, who did not get me. And to be honest with you, I don't think I probably got him. One of his close friends came to me very early in the ministry and said, you know, maybe you ought to resign. I don't think you're good for the church. There was pressure. But let me tell you, to that man's credit, he chose something, though he didn't get me. He chose to hang on to me. And to my credit, I was just a 28-year-old kid. I didn't get him either, but I'm not turning loose of him. We went to lunch probably 3, maybe 4 years every month. And we would go and sit, and sometimes they were even strained meals. But we would sit in the parking lot in his car, and we would talk, and he would wipe a tear, and he would say, "Though I'm frustrated at you, I am not turning loose of you, and I believe God is up to something in your life, and I want to see what it is." And I would wipe a tear every now and then going, "You know, you're one of the strongest personalities I've ever met in my entire life. But I believe you're a man who I have a lot to learn from." We hung on. You need to know at the end, I mean, I was at College Heights until he passed away. Then I was there longer. But at the end of his life, he came in one day and he said, "Randy," he said, "I'm a strong personality." He said, I've not handled conflict the way I should have through the years. And he said, I've got people I need to ask their forgiveness before I pass away. And he said, "Randy, you know my heart." He said, "We've gone through hell together and we came out the other side." And he said, "Randy, I know you love me." He said, "Randy, would you make the appointments for me, and would you go with me? Would you drive me?" And I went place after place with this old lion, would sit down and ask people their forgiveness. He might wink and say, "I still think you were the one who was wrong." But he would smile and he would say, "But I didn't handle my part well. Would you please forgive me?" And I watched this man go that circuit. You hang on to each other. Jay St. Clair, I was on staff with Jay St. Clair for over 30 years. Jay was 19 when we started. Jay's so different than I am, and I'm so different from Jay. God makes 64 Crayolas in the box, and yet I can tell you we deeply loved each other and do love each other. For most of that last set of years, he lived in the house next to me. It's got a little bit of a distance between the houses, but Jay, when he moved in, we were probably bumping heads over something. Every now and then I would say, "Jay, you can't do that." And Jay was saying, "Randy, you're blind to something." And so we would have the natural stuff on a staff, just part of it. Jay St. Clair mowed a path from his house to my house. He said, "I want you to know that's the metaphor. I'm never turning loose of you." And he mowed a path between our houses. Every time I look out, do you go to my house today and there's a mowed path? There's a visual sign, "I'm not turning loose of you." There's a visual sign. There's a path between our houses. And we were two brothers in Christ who shared that ministry for over 30 years. Julie is saying to you, there's something more than the issues at hand when you work through conflict. I want to pull this down. I want to go very specific. And we don't have time enough to do it. Terrific. There's a passage that changed my life. Grab your Bible and turn to Ephesians 4. Take your neighbor's Bible if you have to. Whatever you need to do. Grab this and turn to Ephesians 4. Ephesians 4 is a passage that literally saved my life. I grew up in a family that the men were pretty explosive. I grew up in a family that honestly didn't filter your words. And the reason you didn't filter your words is because you could always say somebody else made you mad. You could always say, "Hey, I tried to be nice, but you wouldn't let me be nice. So I have to finally." And so what happened is Ephesians chapter 4 was a passage that allowed me to finally have a frame of what to work with when Julie and I or my kids or any of you. Doesn't mean I've always practiced it well, but I will guarantee you that this is the passage that I hold to and want to practice. And when I've blown it with you, I am so sorry, but I know it's been a violation of the deepest thing I believe out of Ephesians 4. Ephesians 4 says, whenever you talk, and you do have to talk with people, whenever you talk with individuals, there are three rules to godly speech. When the three rules to godly speech, when I give them to you in this text, they will not shock you or surprise you. The three rules individually are all there, and you go, "Yeah, I try that one, I practice that one, I try to practice that one, and I try to practice that one." You need to know that you're in a culture that practices them separately and independently. The three rules are worthless independent. Standing on their own, they do not work. They are only good when they are woven together and in the exact same conversation and exact same sentences. When they are together, it's wonderful. Julie may fix a recipe that has flour, vanilla, and shortening, and it's a great product at the end. But try to serve the vanilla on Thursday, the shortening on Friday, and flour or whatever it is on Saturday, they're all lousy individually. All three of these are worthless separate. They have to be woven together. And when I finally figured out this is what I've got to do to change from ungodly speech to godly speech, when I began to weave them together, it finally began to be a place where I could maybe be a bit more of a peacemaker than I had been. And here they are. Verse 25 will be the first one. Ephesians 4, verse 25, I memorized them years ago, had to in the New American Standard, so it won't even match anything. But verse 25 says, stop lying to each other. Stop lying to each other. And speak truthfully to one another. Speak truth. He's going to say in verse 26, he's going to say, don't let the sun go down on your anger. Which means what? You put them together. You speak the truth and you speak the truth today. And he's going to say in the next verse, don't give the devil a foothold. What he means by that is, Randy, if you don't speak the truth and speak the truth today, you're giving the devil a foothold. Here is the first rule of godly speech. You must tell the truth. Now, I want to put a little quick disclaimer in. You don't have to say to people, your roommate, your friends, you don't have to say every thought that crosses your mind. Sometimes we're just controlling people. Sometimes we're just people who like to have our own way. Sometimes we're people who are just insensitive and we're just talking. Not every thought that crosses your mind do you have to speak. So let's lay that aside. That's terrible immaturity. But you do have to speak the truth on things that matter. Most of us say, well, I'm a truth teller. Yes, you are, except for two occasions probably. There's probably only really two occasions you don't tell the truth. One is when you're trying to be nice, and another one is when you're mad. But other than that, you nearly always tell the truth. That really is accurate. You watch how often we don't tell the truth when we're trying to be nice. You can take any number of illustrations. A girlfriend comes and says she's kind of sweet on that guy, and that guy's kind of sweet on her, and she wants to know, do you think they'd make a good couple? And you're trying to go, well, I can be honest or I can be nice. I can be honest or I can be nice. I can be Christian or I can be honest. I can be, you know, and so what you do is you build an altar of kindness, and the first thing you do is sacrifice truth on it. The girl wants to come in and she wants to borrow clothes from your closet. You didn't mind the first three times? She wants to know if she can borrow it again. She's the sloppiest eater on campus, and she's in your closet constantly. And you say, well, I could be kind or I could be honest. I could be kind or honest. You volunteer in a ministry and somebody has a suggestion for you and want to know what you think. You can be nice or you can be honest. And some of the most dishonest people on the face of the earth are Christians, because Christians prioritize kindness over honesty. You need to know that's a trap. It's a terrorist trap. It never works. I'd love to flesh this out for you. Truth always has to be there. Any lie you tell will eventually come back. And so when you begin to say untrue things, trying to be nice, eventually it shows up. And what happens is people figure out they can't trust your words. They have to watch your eyes and your face. And now they start judging you by nonverbals, because the last time you told me you didn't mind, but I found out you really did mind. And so now what I have to do is watch you and go, oh, I can tell you don't like that. No, I do like it. No, I can tell by your face you don't like it. And you fall into this horrible pattern. The one thing you got to be is a truth teller. The second place we tend to be dishonest is when we're angry. Angry people almost always exaggerate their point to make their point. If Julie decides that we're going to fix meals and sit down at home and I need to be home at time, and I'm making a silly illustration here, but if she's really ticked, because at the end of 2 weeks, I've been there 11 times on time, and three times I haven't, if she's really ticked and out of line, what's the chance, as this smoke comes out of the oven, something burnt because I'm so stinking late, what's the chance she's going to go, sweetheart, I really appreciate how hard you've worked to be here the 11 times, but the three times you haven't have really kind of goofed things up. If she's really ticked and out of line, the chances are she's going to start exaggerating your point. Randy, we decided 2 weeks ago, and you don't keep your word. Randy, you told me this, but you don't follow up. Randy, and I'm thinking of all the times I tried to honor it, and she's given me this paintbrush that doesn't fare. Honestly, we overstate our point to make our point when we're mad. Sometimes we just simply violate that text when it says, be honest. It's an imperative. Be honest. Some of you with roommates, you have problems in your... In this relationship, because you don't know how to be honest. If you're not honest, bad things happen. James Dobson made the comment. He said that most bitterness honestly comes to Christians because they withhold the truth. You think you're supposed to be kind and you withhold the truth, and then your mind begins to run like a jailhouse lawyer on the inside, and you have this tell the truth. Now, love to flesh that out, but that's another day. But I also want you to know, the Bible never says, just be honest. You're never told, just be honest. If somebody says, well, at least I'm an honest person, run to the hills, run for your life. Because pure honesty is harshness. Years ago, this guy named Bob, when I was a student here, there was a guy named Bob that ran all the chemicals the college used for cleaning. And he was in charge. And I came from a science background. I was sort of curious. And I went in because he has a pint jar of this, a pint jar of this, a pint jar of this, a pint jar of this. And then he has this 3-gallon jar and a pint jar of this and a pint jar. And so I just asked Bob one time. I said, what do you use this 3-gallon jar for? He said, oh, nothing. I can't use it for anything. Well, that makes a lot of sense. You have 3-gallon of it and pint jars and everything else. And he said, it's way too caustic. If I used it on anything, it would eat up sinks, eat up floors, it would eat up anything. Well, then why do you have it? His answer was, it's my base chemical. But I have to mix this with it to clean sinks, and I have to use this with it to clean floors. I have to use this with it to clean walls. I use this with it. Base chemical was why he had the 3-gallon jar. Truth will always be your base chemical. But if you ever use truth without the other things added to it, you're out of line. So the second thing is verse 29. Let no unwholesome word proceed out of your mouth, but only use words that are good for edification according to the need of the moment. Let me give grace to those who hear. By the way, the word benefit shows up in the NIV. I actually like the base word for grace is in that text. Randy, whenever you speak the truth to someone, Randy, you make sure that there's no garbage words that come out of your mouth. But only use words that lift people up, that are grace words. Wow, I don't know how to be mad at you and be really ticked at you and be really offended at you and to raise you up, to treat you with more dignity. I know how to jerk you down to size and how to pop your bubble. I know you're too big for your britches. I know how to take you up here where you think you are and put you down where you really are. I know how to take you from up here and put you here. But I don't know how to be mad at and hurt at you and raise you up. So we just separate them. You bottle it up inside. You didn't tell the truth when you should have told it. A little bit of bitterness built up. You finally fired and you said whatever it was you said, the sniper or whatever it was. And then you felt bad about it the next day. So you went and you said, hey, you know, if I overstated my case yesterday, I'm sorry about that. Bummer if I did. You need to know that's an abuser's pattern. You did hear me, didn't you? Last night, somewhere in Joplin, a mama slapped a 5-year-old baby way too hard. She slapped that child. She threw that 5-year-old into bed. And she said, you pushed my buttons too long, kid. And she's got a sobbing little 5-year-old girl in a bed somewhere in Joplin last night. And as that mama walked out, she thought to herself, I'm not a bad mama. I'm not a bad mama. I'm not a bad mama. So she woke that child up this morning, and she said, hey, would you like to go to McDonald's and play in the balls, and would you like to get a Happy Meal? And the kid doesn't know any better. It's just the only life they have. And going, sure, let's go to McDonald's. And so the mama takes her child to McDonald's. That child's playing in the balls and having a Happy Meal right now. And the mom's going, see, I'm not that bad mama. No, it's an abuser. If you're somebody who says hard things because you're ticked or offended, but you make up for it later by how you treat people and the dignity, and it's not your fault that you tried to be nice and they wouldn't let you be nice. You need to know you're really wrong. When you open your mouth, your truth and your edification better be so laced together. You want to know how to get fenced off in life? I'll tell you how you get fenced off in life. It's pretty simple. Just separate them out. If you have that water fountain out there, it's a good water fountain, by the way. Every now and then, the physical plant department says, you know, it siphons sewage once or twice a year, that water fountain does. We don't know why, but sewage from the stools comes through that water. But don't worry about it. It only happens every now and then. It's good water 99% of the time. Only sewage every now and then. We always put a sign up, would you drink out of the water fountain? Do you want to know why you're fenced off in life? It's because you're somebody who separates your truth and your edification. People will stop believing your blessings. Truth, edification, let's drop down to the third one. Verse 32, be tenderhearted, forgiving, just as God in Christ has forgiven you. The word humility is not in that text, but here's what it means. Never be more than that far from humility. And so how do you confront somebody? How do you talk through stuff? Julie's right. You don't start with the other person. You start with worship, and God, reveal to me my own selfishness in this. But when you do begin to speak, here's what you do. You have to weave together three things, which is, I need to be honest with you. I caught myself upset with you today. I don't know if I should or shouldn't. This may be my issue. I honestly do not know, but I do know I owe it to you to tell you that did work on me this morning, and I didn't handle that well. But I also have been forgiven by an awful lot of people. You need to know forgiving you will not be hard. And maybe I'm the one at wrong, but I have to tell you, this is what it felt like. I don't know how you do it, but you weave together three things. Those three things saved my life. Can I tell you, on this continuum of honesty, edification, and humility, everybody told you, count to 10 before you say anything. Well, what do you think about? How do I say something with honesty, edification, and humility? Everybody struggles at one end of these. For some of you, telling the truth is so stinking easy, but edification and humility, you struggle with. For some of you, edification and humility comes really easy, but it would take you 3 days to tell the neighbors their house was on fire, because you just can't get yourself to speak the truth. All of that is ungodly speech. Ephesians 4, it saved my life.
I wished every conflict could be resolved, but it's probably not going to be. And I'm not sure that should be the ultimate goal. The ultimate goal should always be to restore a relationship. That should always be more important than resolving a conflict. People, we're called to be peacemakers. It's to be the mark of a Christian. Matthew 5. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Romans 12, make every effort to live at peace with your brothers and sisters. Be united with peace, Ephesians 4. We're called to be peacemakers. But we've picked up some ugly habits from this culture. And we're becoming a people that just unfriend whoever disagrees with us or sees things differently or whatever it may be. You can't be in a ministry team and just because you don't agree with that person, just unfriend them. And it's wrong when we're in dorm situations and you know, I just don't see eye to eye with my roommate. Well, I know that's going to happen, but you don't unfriend them. You work hard to restore the relationship. Why is that so important? Well, here's why. Matthew 5 will tell you. If you've got something and you're going on your way to worship and you suddenly remember somebody's got something against you, what are you supposed to do? You leave your offering and you go and restore, get reconciled. It is so important because you can't have this relationship here with God if you're out of sorts on the horizontal. Scripture even tells us unrestored relationships will hinder our prayers. Look at 1 Peter 3 you got the example of the husband that doesn't treat his wife right, and the warning is there that kind of activity will hinder the prayers. It's important to restore relationships.
Matt, would you come up here if you wouldn't mind? James talks about, I don't know what was happening in the church. I don't know what was happening in all of the, at all the staff assemblies. But in James, he talks about division between brothers. And his advice really is this: God opposes the proud but favors the humble, so humble yourself before God. That's his answer to conflict. So humble yourself before God, resist the devil and he'll flee from you. I think that's in the realm of bitterness, honestly. Come close to God, and God will come close to you. Wash your hands, you sinners. Purify your hearts, for your loyalty is divided. He drops on down in verse 10 and says, humble yourself before the Lord, that he will lift you up. This morning, the whole of your life, you're going to need this life skill. The whole of your life, you'll be getting better at it. But can I tell you, there's one place we always have to start. Not everyone can go to their knees. We realize that. If you're able to go to your knees, I want you to do so. I'm going to simply ask that President Proctor speak a blessing over us, to speak to our own hearts. Would we finish on a prayer time on our knees this morning on this subject? We invite you to go if you're able.
Father, we need your grace, and so we humble ourselves before you this morning. And we come with gratitude because we know that we were your enemies in our minds because of our evil behavior. We were in conflict with you, and yet you did not unfriend us. You did not delete us from your life, but you sent Christ, who humbled himself, emptied himself, became obedient to death, even death on a cross, to mow a path from your place to ours. Thank you that you were willing to let your own body be broken and your blood be shed to make peace with us. Forgive us for the times when we are not willing to pay a lesser price to make peace with those with whom we have conflict. Lord, I pray that you would help us as we look into our own hearts and give us open eyes. Help us not to justify our behavior. And Lord, as I've heard my friend Mark Scott say, even if we're right, help us to want to be righteous more than right. To not worry about who may have the high ground or the low ground, but that we would want the relationship to be restored, the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace, and that we would want it so much that we would empty ourselves like Christ, that we would let go of pride and self-protective dignity, that we would come humbly, speak words of truth, grace, humility, and that we would make peace as you have made with us. Lord, let this community here on this campus flourish. Let us model this, and then let us take it to a world at odds with you and with each other. Lord, we need Jesus. We pray all this in his name. Amen. You're dismissed.